I've spent a lot of my time, energy in my life to defend women, to fight for women, to make sure that women are respected, to make sure that people understand how much they contribute, including in this institution, the IMF. And I think anything that is not in that category of respect, dignity, is of zero interest to me.
I obviously understand and appreciate that you're not going to enmesh yourself into the US political system or make a political comment. But the fact that this has been said in this way and has come out now, as one of the world's most influential women, what message do you send as a result of that?
Respect women, and it's the dignity of human being to actually respect one another.
Taking that forward then, how does the process factor in these sort of events, the political process factor in these sort of events, do you think? Because obviously everybody has to work out what happens next. And again, I realize you don't want to comment on the US political process, but it feeds into this bigger issue of what's happening in society at the moment, don't you think?
I think all of us, I'm trying to look at things from where I stand and what I have to do as a mission for the IMF. I think our job is to explain in intelligent, understandable terms the things that we see about life, about jobs, about the economy, about security, about climate change, about corruption, about inequality, and propose solutions to remedy the problems that we are observing. I think people critically want to get jobs. They want to be integrated in society. They want to be respected. They want dignity. And there are lots of economic ways to address that. There are all sorts of other ways, political, sociological, blah, 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 you name it. But from my perspective, I think our duty is to propose solutions that address real problems that we have today. And there are plenty of them, but there are also plenty of solutions, and that's what I want to work on.
You have described the mantra I come away from these meetings. Growth has been, what's your phrase?
It's too low for too long, benefiting too few.
Is anybody listening to you?
They'd better listen, because I'm going to shout this morning.
I'm sorry? You're going to shout?
I'm going to be a lot punchier, and I would like them to go away thinking, what can I do? I can do something. Even if I am in this fiscal constrained environment, even if I think that I've exhausted my structural reforms, even if I think that monetary policy is exhausted, we can do something. That's what I want to say.
Okay, so with that shouting, or as much as one does,
I will be firmly explaining all that.
Firmly, we're firmly explaining, right. As you firmly explain, do you think the leaders, whether it's finance ministers, prime ministers, presidents, people you meet, do you think they get it that they're in a new environment of angry populace who are prepared to rebel?
They know that they need to create economic conditions that respond to people's expectations. What is my future? What will be my job tomorrow? Do my kids receive the right education for the jobs that will be out there tomorrow? Am I secure in my day-to-day life? Those are the concerns of people. They have to answer. The best way from an economic point of view to answer is to have some growth. They can create, we can collectively, because it's also an important thing to do it together, they can collectively create the conditions for more and better growth.
And as your grandmother said,
everything is better with butter. Everything is better with growth.